last 10 years, sea levels have risen at an alarming rate. Been affected by extreme weather.
The way that we can help reverse global warming is to remove some of that CO2 from the air. One of those ways is using machines for direct air capture.
Our dependence on fossil fuels for energy has led to rising amounts of carbon dioxide being released into the air. Carbon dioxide, along with methane and nitrous oxide, contribute to the greenhouse effect, trapping thermal energy close to the surface of the Earth and causing the global temperature to rise and the climate to change. But climate change is not the first time humanity has had to overcome a global threat using chemistry. At the turn of the 20th century, the world was facing extreme famine. Nobel Prize-winning chemists Fritz Haber and Karl Bosch developed what may be the most important scientific discovery of the century, a chemical process to create fertilizer by synthesizing ammonia from nitrogen in the air, making fertilizer affordable and accessible, and changing the way we approach agriculture. With a new and sustainable food supply, our global population quadrupled over the next 150 years. The dramatic rise in population has increased our reliance on energy and dependence on fossil fuels to support human life. For 10,000 years leading up to 1950, temperatures only varied 1 degree Celsius. If we continue at our current pace of fossil fuel consumption, we will exceed a 3 degree increase by the end of the century, leading to an even greater release of carbon dioxide into the air. We must keep global climate change below 2 degrees Celsius to avoid potentially catastrophic climate change events that will endanger the way we live today.
Society will need to use more renewable energy, less fossil energy, coupled with wide-scale deployment of direct air capture to stabilize the climate.
And unlike most threats, you can't see it. Carbon dioxide is imperceptible to the human senses. Carbon dioxide is notated as CO2 and is a naturally occurring trace gas. Built from one carbon atom and two oxygen atoms, carbon dioxide is about 60% denser than dry air. While it does have a major environmental impact, it is only dangerous to humans in high concentrations. We produce CO2 by breathing. It can be found naturally in seawater, rivers, ice caps, volcanoes, and natural gas deposits. While we will always produce carbon dioxide through natural sources, the CO2 we are concerned about is released through the consumption of fossil fuels. Once carbon dioxide is released, it exists in our atmosphere for hundreds of years, insulating and warming the Earth. The ocean has been affected too. It has been absorbing about 30% of the carbon dioxide in the atmosphere. Carbon dioxide is very dilute, coming in at only 400 parts per million, making it challenging to capture from the air. To slow global warming and reduce the effects of climate change, we need to remove 10 gigatons of carbon dioxide a year by 2050, increasing to 20 gigatons a year by 2100. If we meet these goals, we will be able to achieve negative carbon dioxide emissions by 2090. To do this, chemists have developed an approach using direct air capture technology. Let's examine the chemistry used to capture carbon dioxide. Amines are nitrogen-based organic compounds derived from ammonia. They are built by replacing one or more of the hydrogen atoms with a carbon atom. Amines are incredibly chemisorbent, or sticky, and hold on to carbon dioxide through chemical bonds. When carbon dioxide makes contact with the amine, it gives off heat through the formation of a carbon-nitrogen bond, holding the carbon dioxide captive. Once designed and manufactured, amines are used as a key ingredient in the creation of amine-modified solids, a coating that is grafted onto the walls of a suitable contactor, like a monolith.
The contactors used in direct air capture are a bit like a catalytic converter in your car in that you can pass large amounts of air across them. However, these materials for direct air capture are modified with amines on their surface, which grab the CO2 out of the air.
Once the monolith has been created, it is placed into the direct air capture technology.
Direct air capture technologies typically involve three steps: removal of CO2 from the air, collection of that CO2, and injection underground for storage geologically.
Direct air capture machines pull air with about 0.04% carbon dioxide into the monolith. Inside the machine, air passes through the monolith, coated with the adsorbent amine modified solid, as carbon dioxide binds to the structure. Most other components of the air pass through without getting stuck, with the exception of some water molecules. The monolith continues to collect carbon dioxide until it reaches its optimal capacity, as determined by the engineer. The monolith is moved from the adsorption phase into the desorption phase, or from capture to release. This process requires an energy input, often in the form of heat, as well as vacuum, to extract carbon dioxide from the amines. The applied energy warms the chamber to 60 to 120 degrees Celsius, depending on the process. To liberate the carbon dioxide from the adsorbent bonds, heat in the form of steam is added. At this point in the process, the highly purified carbon dioxide is free from most other components of air and is collected for storage. The steam is recycled for the next collection. Once the carbon dioxide has been captured, there are two primary solutions for managing the material. The first is to sequester it underground.
Once we capture the CO2 from air, then we can store it underground. And there is then a chemical reaction that takes place between what's essentially fizzy water and the CO2 is turned into stone.
Another helpful approach is to repurpose the captured carbon dioxide for commercial purposes, like clean fuel.
If we think about using CO2 as an alternative to petroleum, in the context of reducing global emissions, it's really attractive.
The CO2 can also be delivered to greenhouses, so they use the CO2 as an airborne fertilizer.
So we've got it all figured out, right? Not exactly. As we race toward our 2050 goal of 10 gigatons of carbon dioxide extracted each year, we are challenged.
The biggest challenge with direct air capture is cost. We need to figure out ways to reduce the costs of operating and identify valuable uses for the carbon dioxide once it's been captured.
Our ambitious goal will require thousands of direct air capture machines spread across tens of thousands of square miles of land around the globe. Each location will need custom chemical solutions to help react to the unique geographic and climatic conditions. Direct air capture is just part of the solution to climate change.
Carbon removal from our atmosphere is one of the biggest challenges of our time right now.
We really need people who think outside the box and willing to take risks with crazy ideas.
Are you up for the challenge?